speakers will discuss how to create future stakeholders, consumers, and audiences for the arts and culture. We have with us Administrator Inlaks Shivdasani Foundation, Amita Malkani, Head Arts and Culture Tata Trust, Deepika Sorabjee, and co-founder and curator of Harkat Studios, Karan Talwar. They will be in conversation with gallerist and founder at Tarq, Hena, Kapadia. For more about each of them, please do take a look at our brochure. And over to you, Hena.
Hi, everyone. I think we've been sort of having a little bit of pre-conversation about what we're going to talk about today. And I think we're going to, the whole idea of the panel is we're going to discuss the importance of creating younger stakeholders. And when we say stakeholders, we're talking really about three types of stakeholders. First and foremost, of course, is the artists and the talent that we, that everyone on this panel supports in their own capacity. The second, and I think also equally important, is building building newer, younger audiences. And the third, which for I think all of us is possibly the most interesting, is also supporting arts professionals and arts management while we kind of run organizations and do those kind of things. So I'm going to start by briefly asking everyone how they choose who they decide to support and how Inlaks, the Tata Trust, and Harkat Studio decide how they're going to program themselves. Amita?
Rather than get into who we support and how we support them, maybe I could just tell you about how we decide to go with certain kind of programming. So what we really do is, what we've tried to do is respond to what we call the need of the day. And it started off with, initially we used to support, we were one of the very few institutions who gave scholarships for artists wanting to study abroad, doing a graduate degree, say a master's degree at the Royal College of Art. And then we saw that over the years, especially with the art boom in India over the last 10 years, that no one wanted to spend 2 hours away from India. And what they really wanted to do was to attend residencies. So though we do continue with the scholarship program, what we put into place was quite a robust overseas residency program. And so we call this responding to the need of the artist community. One of the other initiatives we've done like that is a couple of years ago, Kavita Singh from GNU said that there was a real need for a curatorial discourse to be started. So we started off with a curatorial lab at GNU, which really took off, and I'm happy to see that a lot of other institutions started similar courses. And together with that, we also supported people at curatorial studies at FICCI, at Goldsmiths together with FICCI. And we also support curatorial practice at residencies. So this is how we respond to the need. All our selection is done through an open call system. And we put out, and we advertise the opportunity to the community. And then we have a very, very transparent selection process. And we have eminent people from within the field who... what we're looking for is talent and giving opportunity to those who've not had it before. And naturally, we do have a very strict age limit in place because it is all about the young and enabling the young.
Deepika, more in the it's on. I think more in the context of Tata Trust, I think where there is and sort of what we are talking about is a larger bureaucratic system in place. How do you kind of find the space to work with the arts, which is very dynamic in its own way?
I think rather than a bureaucratic system, it's what needs to be understood is that we are not a pure arts foundation. The Tata Trust supports works in the field of development. And therefore, it's one among many other areas that they work in. And we are a very small percentage of what the funds actually go to. So in that sense, that you and they have been around 100 years. So I think as a foundation that's been around for over 100 years, you're constantly evolving towards the needs that are needed in that particular area. I have been with the Tata Trust only for about 4 years of its 100 years existence, or over 100 years existence. And in the last 4 years, we've set up the Tata Trust Art Archives, which has actually taken us back to see how we've supported what we've supported. Is that your question? That when we started out, very similar to the Inlaks Foundation, this was in even pre-independence and then post-independence, they were mainly individual grants that were given. And these were given across health, education, and the arts. Subsequently, they moved into institution building as they felt that there were certain areas that needed a solid institution. And these it was in the sciences, TIFR, NIAS in Bangalore, IIS, and also in the arts, the NCPA, which is now celebrating its 50th year. From institution building, they moved on to supporting specific organizations who were working specifically with certain gap sectors, and those were the NGOs that came up in the 70s and 80s. And subsequently now, there's again a shift because they find that they've assessed what's been happened over the last 100 years, and they're trying to impact, we've been asked to impact areas directly through community and through programs that we try and design ourselves using whichever partners are there on the ground. So in that sense, I would say that we've had to have a certain kind of strategy. It's not a kind of the corporate way of strategy, but a kind of focus on where you look at where you put your money. And about 2010, there was a strategy commissioned from practitioners in the field, from crafts, worked in crafts, in across the sector in performing arts, in conservation, in education. And that report suggested that there was a gap in conservation, in performing arts, and craft. Subsequently, when I joined, I brought in art education. And so these are the areas that we work in. I can talk about three of them. Craft is looked after by somebody else. With art education, again, we further focused where we were going to work to. As you say, there is a need for building up art professionals or strengthening institutions that can support artist work. And in that sense, we've chosen to focus on the tertiary level in art education. So we do not look specifically at working with the arts in schools, because we find that's the easiest place that gets funding from CSR. So we try to go to areas where it is really difficult to obtain funding. And you're talking about funding in this nation where less than 1% goes into health. So if you are going to ask the government for funding for the arts, it's going to be, I think, just fractional of that, less than 1%. So you're looking at other alternatives. And so therefore we've chosen, and I'll give you specific examples later in where we've gone into these disciplines. And we continue to work with conservation. Over the last 3 years, we've gone in moved from project base into setting up systems where you can address the sector and try and lay a bare infrastructure in that sector. And in performing arts, again, it's difficult. So there there's so much multiplicity in our country, and there's so much of the art form that's marginalized. And by marginalized, I mean not just in terms of gender or caste, but also in region, in economic factors. And therefore, this access that it becomes primary in all the programs that we try and support, where we can give access to these marginalized art forms or people or region, or in terms of gender or caste, where that makes the most impact. And across the board, we layer. So if we worked in performing arts, say in contemporary dance, in art education, we try and substantiate that by making it into a professional course within a university. So that, looking, and our archives have been very helpful in trying to help us where we can build on and form the sector we worked in previously. So that's just something in brief.
Check. Yeah, okay, cool.
Check. Can you tell us a little bit about Harkat and what you do and how you choose what you do?
I think in terms of choosing, we are a
the idea of the space and the context of how the space came into being was sort of addressing a, actually just listening to the arts community and listening to the needs of the city and as a an organism on its whole. And I think the way we choose is exactly that. So it kind of like became that we approached the idea of a space, of an institution, of a theater, or of all of these things put together from the ground up. So it's sort of like a maker space, and we just sort of went in with the feeling that if there's a space and if we start to do interesting things there, people will respond. And that's what we do. We have an open door policy. Anybody can come in, anybody can write in, and anybody who has something to do, show, is welcome to come, write in, and then if they fit a certain curatorial that we keep shifting every now and then, like we're a very nimble, small organization, so we'll keep trying to shift ourselves in different things that we try to keep addressing, like we run a children's program over Sundays, we run an arts engagement for children, do things like the Museum of Ordinary Objects, which is happens every year. And then we'll do a whole lot of things in the performing arts, in film, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. All of these, everything is really just listening and doing. And that's how it's come into being. It's a makerspace. You just come in and you'll not only get a platform, not only get an audience, but then also there's ticketed shows. You can enable yourself to sort of fund yourself, and then hence.
So I think a lot of what we've been talking about just now is arts organizations responding to what they think the art community needs. Could each of you tell us a little bit about the impact that you think the organization has had? You know, Amita, if it was in terms of Kochi or, you know, things like that, you know, if we can just go through the impacts that you feel each organization has had.
It's very difficult. Really measure impact. It's just what, you know, you'd say how successful the, you know, the artist has been. So in the field of art, we have people whom we've supported are people like Rekha Rudwitya, Sheila Gowda, Jagannath Panda, Rimzan, Suresh, Indra Pramit, Roy. I mean, the name, it's a never-ending list. And among the younger lot, Himali Bhuta, Sahej Rahal. So we've had a lot of very successful artists. Also at the recent Kochi, we had 8 people who actually participated, who've been supported by the foundation, some through curatorial programs, some through regular scholarship, some through the Fine Arts Award. To that extent, that sort of reflects the success. For the first time this year, we were invited by the India Art Fair to show our artists. And I think that was a huge acknowledgement of the work we do, because we have an absolutely zero commercial interest in any kind of showing. So that our young artists who had just been chosen and our alumni were given the opportunity to show at the IAF was, I think, acknowledgement of, you know, the fact that it's sort of, they're doing well. We also support people in the field of music, theater. We support people at the Film Institute. I mean, we're primarily a scholarship organization, but we do have a large involvement in culture. In the field of music, we've been supporting a person who's put up 2 operas at the recently set up opera house. In theater, we have people like Abhishek Mazumdar, who's written his own plays and has really, performing in London at the moment. He has a show running there. These are sort of very young people coming up, but I think they're impacting their, you know, audiences in various ways. What are the other fields, I'd say? Dance, we've been supporting people at Gati and Atakalari, and Gati now has become part of their contemporary arts program, has become part of the Ambedkar University program, I think, thanks to you all. Yeah, so I think that's a case of incredible support, which has really gone the right way.
Just to build on what Amita said, this is where it's nice to collaborate with other arts foundations work over the years. I think that's how one should go the way forward, because we've got limited resources, and if you can keep building on what somebody else has done, you start laying infrastructure. So Gati, what she mentioned, this is the first practice-based masters in contemporary dance in the country. JNU had one, but it was only theory. So this is at Ambedkar University, and we insisted it be a practice-based one, so they're having it in the Gati studios. And it took a long while working with, that's the other thing about infrastructure in this country, working with institutions and government. You not only have to satisfy their criteria, their procedure, we have a lot of procedures, so it takes a lot of time to get going. With Kochi, we, in art education, we support the Students Biennale, which is the art education wing of the Kochi Biennale. And this is something that we've worked twice with them on, and it's wonderful to see how it's progressed. So the first one, we weren't involved. The second one saw it expand, building on ideas that we noticed that didn't happen in the first sector. So for instance, our art colleges are still restricted in their curricula to teaching very basic, minimal, it's painting, sculpture, printmaking, and things like that. So the Biennale actually, the Students Biennale worked with them in new media, in performance, in installation, and you saw that expression in the second Biennale. And but yet, this is a program that engages with about 50 plus colleges around the country. There was a young curators program in place. They went out and selected students. We found that became problematic because the faculty and the curators didn't really, they had issues about which students were chosen. So for this edition of the Biennale, it was an open call. So it was an open call for students. It was selected by a jury of artists who were at Kochi. And then we even had what was successful in the second edition was the exhibition. It just took a leap from the first one. But what happened at the colleges wasn't documented, and I don't think we made any dent in education as such. So that was, again, something that came up in redesigning, and as something that we had in a conversation earlier, that you've got to constantly redesign and see how you can improve on something to make it more efficient and allow other people to build on it. So for this edition, we had a small educators module because to work with artists is extremely difficult. Everyone has their own opinion. So there were five interventions that went into five regional colleges, and those have been documented, and they're going to go online, and the colleges will have access to those ways of teaching, which is a small start in laying kind of, because to attempt to change curricula is very difficult. Again, because you're working with different states in India, we are like a mini continent. You have different laws in different states, and it's just, so if de facto what is happening with the Students Biennale is it's becoming an institution, and therefore if they need to take the responsibility of trying to see how they can, through the Students Biennale, affect the colleges in a very simple way, but taking artists back to teach or things like that. So that's something that can be built on. And currently the art conservation program, I'll talk about that, because that combines everything. It combines bringing a whole cohort of professionals into the field that doesn't currently exist in an organized manner. So this program is working with five institutions around the country, and I'll just very briefly say what we expect at the end of 4 years. So you'll have five established conservation labs around the country. You'll have trained professionals, conservators in that field, workshops that address material technology, attached two of them to each of them, so that somebody who's 18 years old, wants to work in conservation, can get up and say, I want to be a wood conservator, this is where I go. And attached to that, we're also looking at setting up a master's in art conservation, and that we are still in conversation with which university we think we will do. So these are some of the things, I mean, there are lots, but.
The Museum of Ordinary Objects, I think that was very interesting in terms of its engagement. And then also the 16mm Film Festival, if you could tell us a little bit more about those two things.
I'm glad you asked me about two things specifically, because I find impact conversations very difficult, because what counts as a success, what doesn't, who's measuring it, with what barometer, with what spreadsheet is extremely complex and very like difficult to sort of put. In the context of in like talking about the museum and the 16mm Film Festival, the museum is basically a participatory museum where you, it's called the Museum of Ordinary Objects. So everybody, we crowdsource all the objects, so you're allowed to come in with an object. All of them are sourced beforehand, along with a little story. So it could be your grandmother's hair clip. It could be that one bottle of beer that you shared with your girlfriend at some point. And the museum sort of becomes this neighborhood's museum. It's a collection of stories from the neighborhood. So for example, the last exhibit that we did was at Studio Safdar in Delhi. It happened over 3 years at Harkat, and we've recently just taken it out of the space because we thought this is great. This isn't done in collaboration with Choiti, who runs Prime Arts Trust, and Sananda, who runs Extension Arts. And that's sort of, I think the impact of that is beautiful, because it's, because you can see it happening. You can see a neighborhood and its stories and the larger neighborhood unfold like an onion. Like you can just be like, it becomes the, becomes like a contemporary art exhibit of the neighborhood and of the community itself. So I think that is amazing, because then they sort of claim ownership of it, because they'll bring their tie and be like, maine ye yahan pe rakha hai. This is your, our family's object, which I have kept here. And then she will be like, oh, but wait, I have something else which I brought along with me from somewhere. And then when we moved from Jalandhar to here, this is the thing I brought with me. So then it, that sort of is very exciting. So in terms of impact, I would say that's pretty good. But again, very, very immeasurable. I think we should just stop measuring the arts. I think that's a base, like, don't measure it. Just don't. Just do it. It's a pointless, futile exercise. Just trust in artists. As long as you have heart in it, as long as you're doing it with a good intent, and it's all good. As long as the politics is in place, we're all happy. But that's also another debate. The second thing is the 16mm Film Festival. The festival is all about basically working with celluloid film. So we, again, like, I'm a filmmaker actually, and I happened to stumble in the arts world by mistake at some point. I didn't even go to university. So the festival was basically, I've worked in the film industry since the past 12 years now, and I had always worked with physical film as a medium, celluloid film, and then at some point I realized that it's dead when I wanted to make my own films. So then I was like, hey, like, where is celluloid film? I want to work with film. I don't want to shoot on a digital camera. I want to work with film. And then I realized that Kodak has died, and then there's nobody making film anymore. But then very serendipitously, over like 2 years ago, I realized that Kodak has come back, and there's an entire research that's happening in the West where people are shooting on film. So there are big directors like Nolan and people working with film. So then 2 years ago, we started with a festival. It's called the 16mm Film Festival. It's basically about, it comes in with a very clear mandate that we'll only show works which have been made on film. So you make a work on film, and then we'll exhibit it, and we'll try to exhibit it on 16mm itself. And then it's also about enabling a whole new generation of makers to work with film. So then you'll have found footage workshops where you're going to Chor Bazaar, sourcing footage, and then coming back in the space, and then joining it all together, and then reimagining it. Then we do this in collaboration with Kodak itself, and then we do a multitude of workshops of hand developing of film. So it's basically the working around the tactile experience of film. So again, in terms of impact, if I'm to loop back into your main point before I drone off into talking about the festival, is that over the past 2 years, we've supported about 30 filmmakers making their own works on film. So this includes giving them a camera, bringing out the scores of technicians who are now working in the digital medium in the industry, who are all these fantastic people who work with film. Some of them like never studied film also.
We support Shivendra Singh in his film preservation workshops, and we've done it for the last 3 years. In fact, the last workshop we had in Chennai 2 years ago was when I walked in there, and he said, guess who called the week before? And it was Christopher Nolan. And he said he'd heard of the work that we were doing, and he said there's a round table in March 31st. And I said, forget it. And he actually, Tacita Dean, and he came down. But I think where Christopher and Tacita were specific about that, if you really want to, that you take it from a hobby, which is a dying hobby now, to re-bringing film back and preserving it, you had to engage with the others in the industry. So they insisted on meeting with people who were exhibitors. The Kodak people came down. You had theater people, you know, in there, distributors, these are the functionaries who actually will take, had to realize, because from 2014, we overnight in India switched to digital. And both Nolan and I were on the same page as far as digital conservation is going. And I mean, filmmakers are not aware that if they want their grandchildren to see their films, if they're going to preserve it in digital, neither are their grandchildren going to see it in their art form the way it is, nor are they going to monetize it. Because
that hard drive will crash.
Will crash. and that hard drive, every time you make a copy, the copy will be worse and worse until even a Netflix won't be interested in it. So it is imperative that people, and I think filmmakers are just unaware of the the serious, and I asked, in fact, I asked Nolan one thing. I said, which studios do film out, which is when you shoot in digital, how many of the filmmakers actually preserve it in analog? And he looked at his wife and he said, actually only Warner Brothers. So the awareness has to happen everywhere, and it has to happen fast because we're losing out.
Yeah, but what we do actually is something not focused on preservation, because A, that's not, like, I don't know how to do that, and that's Shivendra's, but yeah, but that's the expression. Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. So I think we're at very opposite ends of the spectrum, but there's a massive bridge in the middle where we're like, this is important and we have to do this. But so we've supported a whole bunch of filmmakers working on film, but it's really all about the tactile experience of working with film. If you know your, I think you can't take a oil, like you can't take the easel and oil paints away from a painter. It's almost like, for me, it's like taking away my medium away from me.
I think all of this boils down to kind of access and awareness. So how do you guys spread the word about what you're doing? How do you, I mean, we've talked about open calls and things like that, but what specific strategies do you all engage? I hate the word strategies, sorry. But what sort of... tried very hard. What sort of, how do you program, what sort of methods do you use to spread awareness about what you're doing and to spread awareness and kind of invite as many people as possible to know and participate in what you're doing?
We're a very, very low-key organization. We've been around for about 40 years. We're mainly known for our scholarships, and we find that word of mouth is really the best way to get affirmation of what you're doing and to get participation. But that said, I'm constantly, well, anyway, we have a website, we have a blog, we have a very active blog, we have a Facebook page, unfortunately a closed Facebook page, because for every applicant who gets through, there are at least 999 who don't. So we have a lot of disgruntled people out there also. So it's unfortunately a closed Facebook group. And we have extensive mailing lists. We have mailing lists with individuals, with institutions, anyone we've ever collaborated with. And the response we get to all our calls is more than we can deal with. So we think, I'm constantly being told by my social media person, come on, let's go on Instagram, let's go on Instagram. But I mean, I suppose we'll get there at some point, but until we grow the organization, there's only that much we can. And the underlying thing is that we only deal with really, really high quality, so it's all merit.
The exhibitions that Inlaks supports, the outreach program and those kind of things that, you know, that at Mumbai Art Room you had an outreach program, which also, I think,
we support very few exhibitions per se. We're really all about support of the individual.
it's all support of the individual. Sometimes it happens to be through an institution, and it'll always be a not-for-profit space. So yes, we do have, we support curators and artists at the Mumbai Art Room. And so now we do feel it's necessary for those sort of programs to have outreach programs. So the last show we had by Shonak Mabubani, he had a lot of workshops on gender issues because that related to his show. So that's the kind of outreach we do, but it's really on a very low-key kind of level.
I'll come back to this, but I think also talking about engaging wider audiences that normally don't have access to the arts. So I know Shonak's program at Mumbai Art Room was very focused also on municipal schools and having conversations about gender and those kind of issues in municipal schools. So we'll loop back to also broadening audiences at a later.
Well, I think the Tata Trusts are even more low-key than. And having said that, I think we've touched probably every organization in this country in the arts, whether it's from contemporary art to music to conservation. And I see that in our archives, and I'm continuously shocked. You know, like from somebody like Girish Karnad and Manikol to 80 students this, or 200 students this year in the Students Biennale. Constantly. So we don't actively do anything. We have on our website an open where you can send in anything, and then anything arts come, because like I said, we're not a pure arts foundation, so the arts proposals all come to us, and so that's there. There is Instagram, and there is Facebook. We don't do there is somebody who does it, but you know, and they're constantly after us, but we just say the work speaks for itself, and I think it does. I think just the fact that the kind of proposals we get and the people who come to us, I think they understand where our priorities lie. And so I think that's enough. And for outreach, basically, like now that we're doing programs, everything goes through, like the open call went through Kochi Biennale. Currently, the call for the conservators that we were hiring for the 5 institutes went to each institute, so that you follow the protocol of that institute. And therefore, otherwise it becomes problematic.
So sorry, just to come back to this issue of outreach. Say for the Fine Arts Award, we write to all the institutions. Now, what tends to happen is that it's only schools like Baroda, Ambedkar, Hyderabad, which still produce the most cutting-edge kind of artists. So I think there's a much broader need here, a much sort of wider need to have better art schools spread all over the country. You know, Baroda's dominated the scene for the last 50 years. Ambedkar is now coming up. Hyderabad's coming up. But even if we do, and we do reach out to schools all over the country, their curriculum, the kind of faculty they have, and because ours is all, the choosing is done on merit, it's just not... it doesn't have that edge to it. It's not contemporary enough. So we need to look at the much wider issue of having better facilities for schools which are spread all over the country.
Having said that, I would say that 90% of our work is outside the metro cities. So we get to places that are not in this radar. So that's... And for outreach, like for one of our programs, which is in Dharavi, which is a music program, I mean, simple things like having an event and calling Anganwadi teachers and the parents, then to show them what is happening. So a few events like that happen, but most of the work is outside Bombay.
We are pretty much out there. We are Harkat. So we are not low-key. We don't intend to be low-key. And I mean, at the base of it, actually, I think all grants, in my personal understanding, should just come with an outreach like line item built in, because you're competing with Instagram. The amount of art that you can see on Instagram, the amount of things that you can experience there, at least from a very young generation point of view. Like I'm a gallerist. I'll happily go into a gallery and get into my space and see something, but I feel that it's
is needed. Or we can just wait for Instagram to die and for the next platform to come so that we can just get on there and become influencers there. Huh? Or MySpace. But in terms of outreach, actually we are very, because what we do is sort of, we give a platform, right? So for us it's extremely important, because what I promise you is an audience. And not, and we are very mindful of the kind of audience which shows up for something. So in terms of number making, I can make up some really fantastic numbers because we are full all the time. Like, we are bursting at our seams. We have to find a new place very, very soon because we just can't sustain ourselves, or we have to open up a new space or whatever. But I feel that, so for us, outreach and audience development sort of goes hand in hand in what kind of outreach we're doing. So of all the basics, we do everything that's possible. All the artists that we support and who pass by our space like a Sarai, we end up actually taking control of everything. So we have a graphic design team which will reapproach your creators from scratch. We have a team which will reimagine how you, because artists have many times have a very weird imagination of how they would like to put their work forth. I come from a commercial film point of view. So I worked in commercial cinema. So I'm sort of in that, always trying to bridge that gap. So for me, outreach is extremely important, because for something like the museum or something like the 16mm Film Festival, the people who came in experienced the 80 people, 100 people, 500 people, whatever, however big an auditorium we can find, is of course fantastic for them. It's amazing that they came. But what lives after, or what that is even more exciting, because I think some of the things that we've managed to do have had like completely different tangents of how they've managed to reach so many new audiences, and then they are converted again, and then they are converted again, and then it sort of has this very tumble down effect. And I think it's extremely important. We just cannot ignore it. Like, if the outreach is, and also another thing that I've realized is that outreach is, that will loop back into the arts management conversation later on, is that it's, as an arts manager, you're playing a curator's role, actually. You're bridging, like connecting many different trajectories. So that's what we do. It's all very basic. We do everything. And we constantly, I'll get back to the adaptability conversation, because we are constantly adapting to, if we're promoting film, then how should we do it? So, like, just as a point in that, for example, we realized that there's a lot of music that we support. We support a lot of independent artists. We'll do like accessible Hindustani musical concerts. We'll do accessible English musical concerts. We'll do all kinds of like jugal bandis. We'll have like rap artists coming. Any international artist who's crossing through India is like, they always end up writing to us, and we always end up just programming them in an intimate space of sorts. We started to put their work out. So we were like, okay, we're a film company. We can for sure make a really beautiful video, and we can put your work out there on YouTube, and so many more people will see it. But over a period of time, we realized that audience was dwindling who was actually coming for the show in itself. So we stopped doing that. There's no video online. So it's also like always negotiating a thing of what to put out there and what not to put out there, what to put as a teaser, what to put in full. If you put this entire talk out there, it's not going to do very well in terms of YouTube views. But if you put four... But if you put like make a beautiful 2-minute video out of it, somebody could get context of it, and maybe their mind is spurred to getting inspired.
Maybe they'll also come for the next.
And they come for the next one.
But I think it's really it's really interesting to kind of talk about that, because what I want to talk about, you know, how do we teach? We're also used to looking at art on Instagram, looking at movies on YouTube, looking at things like that. So how do we teach a younger generation who's grown up with all of this? Like, how do we ensure that they come in and that they see the difference between a live performance and a YouTube video? How do they see the difference between an artwork and an Instagram post.
Don't show them the whole thing.
Yeah. Don't give it all away.
But I think it's coming from a film point of view, for example, I'm a purist. I love to watch a film with a projector sitting right next to me and me seeing it on a cloth, and I just want to see it like that. But like that is impossible for me to transport for you on this thing. So what we did for the last festival is that we made a trailer of the projector itself.
Work with that. There is a team that does, but I think what he said is right. You put the whole thing out there, they're not going to put a teaser, and then of course word of mouth goes around. They do come in. I think, I don't know whether you're asking about how do you get different audiences into your space. No. How to stop the digital is not the only thing. Come and engage with the analog.
Rather than the getting stuck in the digital analog, which is sort of a circle, but also sort of getting people more comfortable with coming into these spaces and getting people in schools more used to going to galleries and museums and performances and those kinds of things.
I think it's like something that,
No, it's what we were talking about earlier. I think BDL has been very successful at this, at bringing in juxtaposing contemporary art in an absolutely incredible museum setting. And you've brought a completely new audience in, and I think that's they've made a fantastic success out of it. And I think it should be done in more conventional museum spaces, because I think limiting art to galleries is very, very limiting. So you need to bring it out into spaces where you have, you know, more different kinds of people who would have a chance. The other thing is this movement in the last 1 or 2 weeks, which the artists, musicians, writers, engaging with the elections and the whole democracy thing. I think that's another incredible way of reaching out to new audiences. It is definitely you're bringing in people who've never been exposed to, in a very indirect way maybe, but it's certainly opening up the dialogue and it's bringing more people into the conversation.
I think since we've been knocking you Hena, before the conversation about gallerists, I think some of the galleries in Bombay are doing an incredible job. You run a film, you know, you brought film into your space, which has brought an audience who would never have stepped into your space. And they come back and they're on your mailing list and they tell me now what's happening because I don't keep up. Somebody like, I can see Mort sitting there. Mort is, and Tara have started Culture Bar. They've gotten classical music into their space. They've gotten, you know, Indian class, you know, sculpture. So there's a lot of things that are happening, which I think in the metro cities, I mean, it doesn't happen outside, because you see a completely different picture in our towns and villages where any space becomes a performance venue. But in Bombay, that's not possible because of permissions. And therefore, the existing venues, if they can open up into other forms from what they are showing, and I think, you know, Karan does it like, you know, really well in Harkat, is that's how you will get people in. Our program in Dharavi is run out of a school after hours. So you just have to find those venues and start take programs.
Yeah. So, I mean, a lot of how Harkat was started as well was to approach the idea of a space in a way of, is it possible for a city to have a sustainable neighborhood art space, which is cross-disciplinary, interdisciplinary, like it just does a whole variety of different things. And I feel the kind of new audiences which end up building up into these spaces, I think we've had to constantly reinvent ourselves. So we started from doing very traditional, like just basically adapting proscenium style things into all spaces, because their works didn't exist which would fit into a space like that. So over the past 4 years, we've seen like a multitude of works just being made for alternative spaces, because there's such an explosion across the country in alternative spaces, because they're more accessible, it's in the neighborhood. If you've ever been to Harkat, you can walk down a dusty lane and walk into a bungalow and there's
like friendly faces and you know these people and you can hang out and then you can watch a show and then do all of that. So that's sort of A, that's broken down a massive big barrier that you have to go to noticing it, like just to an NCPA, for example, or to like a gallery. Like there is this like, I'm going to a gallery, like do I need to dress up or like can I just go like how I am? So. But in terms of what we've constantly had to, I know you can respond on that.
The secret to going to a gallery is you can come as you are. We're usually in jeans and like pajamas.
But the thing that we've constantly had to negotiate with is how to shift programming and how to keep doing things in a way at various intersections that sort of bring new people in. And the only way, at least I have, that's like the cheat card way of doing it, is to package it like an experience. So we'll be doing like a, I don't know, we'll be doing just a Hindustani musical concert. If I tell you that, hey, come to this concert, you won't come, but I'll be like, hey, you know, these rags are only performed at 6 p.m. and this is the experience that you're coming in for, and these are the artists, and it's around Holi, and it's the correct time to see it. You know, this is the right time for you to be experiencing this, because you're not going to be able to see this ever again. So there's the arts, packaging it like that, and approaching it things traditional, like the not like simple things very differently, and then there is the thing of involving technology. So then, I mean, then you'll do all kinds of, like, I wish, like, I've seen some fantastic thing in galleries abroad where they'll do, like, all kinds of VR and AR experiments, and they'll do all kinds of, like, that you can, now you can open a QR code on your phone and you can see an exhibition on the street if you want to. I mean, I think Bombay should have that. I think you should do it.
We've been trying. we've played with QR codes before, but then the QR code is really easy to generate. The problem is what it links you to, which takes damn long to produce. But it's also really interesting about sort of harnessing the virtual and sort of stop looking at it as a virtual and analog kind of dichotomy. So I think, I don't know how we're doing on time. Well, we have 10 minutes. 10, 15 minutes. So I think then we'll kind of head towards wrapping up is kind of what is your vision for the future in building younger audiences? What would you like to see changed, improved upon, and how would, I think a lot of what we've been talking about is being our institutions being adaptable and sort of responding to the need of the day, but what do you think is the future need of the day, and how do you plan on changing?
Two main areas which I think need a lot of attention at the moment. One is institution building. I'll just take the example of, we have this wonderful institution in Bombay called the Drama School of Mumbai. They do fantastic work. They need support. I mean, they're the second NSD in the country, as it were. But they need far more support. They can't sustain themselves. They don't have they need support either from the government, but not with interference. I mean, I don't know what the answers are, but we need far more. We need more institutions in the field of theater, in the field of art, all of them. And the second thing is we need more, well, we missed part of the earlier talk, but we need more arts management courses, because we don't have professionals to run institutions, whether they be museums, whether they be whatever spaces in, you know, connected with the arts. We just don't have professionals over there. Everyone has such a high turnover of personnel because people aren't really trained for the job, so they don't really know what to expect to do or to what's expected of them. So these are two areas which really need development, and we're willing to support people wanting to do arts management courses, but they have to come forward, and we need to have more institutions here built, basically.
I think I'll take off from what Amita said, that while we need these arts management courses, you have to give a thought when they come out of these courses, where are they going? And we are a country that doesn't have enough institutions in the arts. I mean, just take the case of contemporary art, just because we are all familiar with it. It's completely privately, it's been built up through private galleries and built up through, say, institutions now, like the Kochi Biennale. So if somebody wants to, and in the past, say in the 70s, 80s, you had this kind of artist, director, collector, but now you have archivists, you have curators, you have writers, you have critics, you have art managers, and where are they going to go? So unless, I think what advocacy here plays a big part, which the art world is not doing. One is really going with hard facts to the government and saying this is what we have, these are the number of performance art venues we have in cities or in the towns, this is what the courses that we have, it really doesn't support the arts. So that's why in our art conservation program, it's basically just to build that infrastructure for a country which has millions of objects and no trained professionals. Currently, there are about 12 senior trained professionals looking after all the objects, and they run from place to place, and things are not happening. The national policy is going to mandate that every institution has a lab. And just the thought of that is a nightmare, because who is going to man these labs? So that's one instance. And the second is, I think, to take your question was taking me out into community. I think you really need to set programs in community. And we have examples from what, some of the programs we've supported, which are doing fantastically. I mean, you just take Neenasam, which is in Hegudu in Karnataka, which is a theater. I've never seen a more theater literate audience around the villages in Neenasam. They're more theater literate than I would say a metro city audience. And in fact, when we wanted to bring one of their plays to Bombay, the director of Neenasam, it was a play on, it was by a Manipuri director who directed the repertory, and it was about the conditions in Assam and AFSPA. And he said, I don't think the Bombay audience will be able to handle it. And I found that so fantastic that you have a theater in a village in Karnataka who were, you talk about, being intellectuals in the cities, but they could handle it, they could see the nuances of it, they could critique it, but he felt that the Bombay audience couldn't. So I think these instances in community, when you place things in community, do work. Our program in Dharavi is not in schools, it's not in the curriculum. It's outside hours because of access. We placed it in Matunga, now we're opening in Chembur and in Govandi, because Matunga is an area which has Hindustani and Karnataka classical music, but it's all middle class and it's all very accessible only if you can you can have that Guru Shishya kind of pedagogy going on. And to us, we've only finished about 9 or 10 months, and it's been difficult because we started with Hindustani vocal, considering that you have Gully Boy out and you have, but we've had now 500 plus enrollments. These are kids who are paying, and not only that, we offer two instruments, piano and guitar. We had 9 kids do the Trinity Laban exam and pass with distinction. And we've got the next round of enrollments. We've got 92 kids enrolled for piano. And it's purely access, because piano is an expensive instrument. They cannot afford it at home. So, you're talking about impact and measurement. We're forced to do something on paper, but the impact is if we can and we're doing it with charging, because if you do everything free, you can't. Now we're opening the centers in Govandi and Chembur, and you have the community who have heard the SCIEN program already coming in to enroll. So we've not even opened in Govandi, and we've got 90 students. So I think this kind of thing where you can, you place it in programs in community, and we support the pilots, and then here, I think when you want something to happen, you've got to think about costing. So when you talk about institutions who are doing excellent work, they have to think about their costing, because they will not be sustainable if their fees are too high. India is not a country that can support those high fees. Then you're limiting your audience again to the students who can afford it. And therefore, you have to look, if you've got something excellent, that's why we place this Masters of Contemporary Dance in a university, because the university is going to take it over after this pilot and subsidize the fees. And that's the kind of thing that people with institution have to think. The last point is, I think, seriously, there have to be not courses in arts management, but courses in fundraising for the arts. There is a lot of CSR money. You have to go and change the mindset of people who are controlling that CSR money, is that, you know, arts just needs to be supported. And there are enough arguments of how it can be an economic driver, because they seem to be bothered only about that. Kochi is an example. So I think your sister worked with Brunswick, and she came down, and he was shocked that the number of institutions that he visited in India, from museums down to small institutions, no one had a fundraising committee. And I think that's a serious area. It is there abroad. They have committees who go out and fundraise and kind of use advocacy against government.
Well, we do have a fundraiser. It's my partner. She's sitting right there. The main half of Harkat. She does the fundraising. But I think I'll pick up on arguments which have already been made. I think sustainability is really the key. Actually, before I move on to that, I think like for example, this program that you're doing in Dharavi is a great example of that. That you just enable something as a spark, and then at some point this is going to become self-sustaining. People are going to you just make people see value in something, and it just runs. Like, you don't really need to, because I mean, frankly, institutions die. Like, big giants will, like, either they're very slow or they're going to collapse at some point. So I come from a very just off my very like little learning, not as like many years as people here have, but from a limited understanding of it, I feel that the future, or rather the way forward, if one wants to engage with younger and newer and audiences and open really accessible spaces, it's really like enabling things in small pockets, like to break the bigger institutions down into smaller functionaries where there are just 2-3 people, 4-5 people, 1-2 people, heartful teams which are just making things happen in smaller. It's just like how alternative spaces in the country are functioning right now. We don't have any funding. In fact, we refuse most of the corporate funding that we get. We don't take corporate funding. We just, because there's always a transaction involved. We don't want to get into a game where, unless it's only Kodak, because they are the only people making film and then they'll die. So, but apart from that, we, and I think smaller models are able to be much more self-sustaining given enough time and effort and speed, and you can just infuse not through arts management practices, because I feel a lot of the art managers who I come across, at least in India, are very European trained, and the European context doesn't apply to India at all, like zero. There's no, I think whatever books you bring from Europe, you should just leave them there and come back here, learn a bit, and then reapproach it from the scratch, because it's really, like, we're all just winging it. Everyone here is just winging it in many ways. So everyone has come up with their own business model in their own way on how they get money, where they spend the money, and how they manage to sustain themselves. And I think if we are able to find interesting ways of enabling that, to just pick up strands of that and make them run with that, that's the key. That's going to be fantastic.